Good morning, everyone. Pleasure to have all of you here in today's webinar, today's session. Of course, at the top of the screen there, you can see two very sharp and handsome gentlemen who have joined me for the discussion in Brian Kane. He's currently in Jamaica at the moment. He was in Barbados a little while ago. Not sure if he's missing it here, but I've also got Brandon Waugh, and he is, I think, maybe a room or two away from me. Right here in beautiful Barbados. Gentlemen, good morning to you. How are you doing, guys?
Morning, Joel. I am doing very, very well and very excited to be here.
Doing
How about you,
good.
Brian? How's the weather in Jamaica right now?
It's sunny at the minute, Joel, and yes, I am missing Barbados too, of course.
I
All my Caribbean islands I love.
think just over a year or so, Brian, we were having a discussion on a similar topic that time that you happened to
We did, yeah.
be next to me. Do you think a lot has changed over that period of a year, Brian?
I think it has. I think a lot of companies, first of all, a lot in the technology space has happened, which is great. You know, it gives people access to new tools and new ways of doing things. But I think a lot of organizations, and I'm pretty sure we'll see it from the data today, a lot of organizations have now switched on to the fact that using the technology and the processes and the people in the correct order and in the correct way, something that matches their organizational setup, can really make a massive difference. And I think we've got a lot of smart people in the Caribbean. I think we've got a lot of really good heads around the table, and I'm looking forward to working with as many people as possible to keep that going, you know?
Yeah, it definitely promises to be an exciting one today. Brandon, before we get officially started, I can't help but notice your last name being Waugh. Any family to the famous cricketers over in Australia, you know, the Steve Waughs and the Mark Waughs?
You know, I want to claim them in my family, but I've never done a trace to see if they are. But as far as I know, they're mine. So yes, I'm sure they're my family.
Is the skill set there as well?
It was there when I was a little younger. I haven't exercised that skill set since I left high school. So hopefully it's not too dormant, but let's see.
There's still time, Brandon. Still time.
Well, I'll bring you to a skill set that I know is definitely down your alley, and that is on the topic of digital transformation. So we're gonna get started. And once again, good morning and welcome everyone to Digital Transformation, Turning Challenges into Opportunities. Now, this is our third survey, our third collection of data that we're doing. And it's in fact our largest as well, because we've surveyed, I believe, 2,500 businesses, and they range from the financial sector, tourism, hospitality, retail, agriculture, as well. And quite a few of them also fall into the category of SMEs. So small and medium-sized enterprises as well have been surveyed and make up a large portion of the data that you're about to receive here today. So you can also look forward to conversations, or rather data, coming out from those who hold positions like CEOs, CFOs, and whatnot. So in terms of the information you're going to hear from our a very esteemed panel today, you can understand that is coming from those who the data actually reaches and who actually participate and interact with the data on a day-to-day basis. So my name is Joel Manning, and my job today is pretty much to get as much information from the two gentlemen who you can currently see on your screen in Brian Kane and Brandon Waugh. And I know that they're filled with a wealth of information, so I'm going to turn it over to, I believe, Brandon to get things started. I believe we're going to start in terms of defining terms, and I think that's going to be our starting base. So good morning again, Brandon. Go ahead and let's get today started.
Morning, Joel. Morning, morning again. Morning, everyone. Thank you, everyone, so much for being here. So, as we talk about digital transformation, it's very important for us to understand what are the facets that actually make up digital transformation, and more so the things that we can leverage in doing digital transformation well. And as the title then says, turning some of those challenges that we experience in going through this cycle or going through this process into those opportunities. So to do that first, I want us to get a clear picture of what is the difference, or what are the differences between digitization, digitalization, and the digital transformation. So let's think about the term digitization. It really refers to taking or converting analog data into something that is of a digital format. So we can think about converting documents, physical documents, scanning them and uploading them into a shared drive or into some kind of online platform or anything of that nature. We could even think about taking books, physical books, into being some kind of ebook version. That in itself is what we call digitization. And then so we move into the aspect of digitalization. which is then streamlining processes for more efficiency. So for us to be able to leverage any of the toolkits or anything within the digitalization space, we must first have to have something that is digital. So we have to first engage in our digitization space. Then having become digital, we now spend the time to how can I improve this process to make sure that it is a more efficient, a better way of delivering value to our customers. And if we think about the different groups that we have that are on the call today, we could talk about it from the standpoint of government or citizens. So you could think about a better way for us to be able to interact with our citizens, for our citizens to interact with the government. And when you think about it from the private sector perspective, it's just a different or a more improved way for customers to be able to interact with the business. So we could think about maybe even from an employee perspective, we could automate our payroll. That could be considered as a digitalization effort. We could talk about online scheduling. That could be considered a digitalization effort. But now when you're going to digital transformation, that generally refers to innovation. It generally refers to our ability to be agile in creating new value for our customers. So for example, in a digitalized space, you may already have, your customers are coming in office or customers are coming in your business to do some kind of transaction with you. It could be a supermarket, it could be a store, it could be anything that you're doing some kind of merchandising with, any kind of transaction. But when you go down the digital transformation perspective, you then create a new way for your customers to interact with you. So that would literally mean moving from this physical way of doing business to maybe an e-commerce platform where you're now hosting things on a website or through some kind of online transaction. So you've created a new way for us to be able to do transactions or work with. In a similar fashion for citizens or government, instead of having to go down to your tax or revenue authority offices to do any kind of tax-related anything, pay your fines, pay your taxes, file anything, you could create an e-government platform that allows you to interact and interface with your government in a much more simpler fashion. Now, as we move into understanding and defining digital transformation, we have to then, or rather we saw from our survey that 77% of the organizations actually say that they have a digital strategy in place in comparison to our last report, which was 61%, which then says to us that people have realized or companies have realized that digital transformation is extremely important for us. The survey also then says to us that 88% of those that responded believe that digital technology will significantly advance their business. And again, this is very telling because we know that where the world is going, that there is the need for us to be able to spend the time to deliver new value to our customers. And before we move forward to the next slide, we have to also define what we consider to be value. And in the using the lean methodology, value is defined as anything that the customer is willing to pay for. It is the thing that they hold most near and dear to them. If you think about value in that format or in that way, then it is how it is that we can make sure that the thing that the customer is willing to pay for is being delivered in a way that they're willing to pay for it, if that makes sense. And once we define it that way, we then realize that digital transformation encapsulates a lot more than just implementing new technology. Because if you've implemented new technology and the customer is not willing to pay for it, then have you actually gone through the full gamut of what digital transformation is? Or have you just spent a lot of money to put in new technology because you have money? So you have to define digital transformation in the context of your customer and your citizen. And once you've done that in a good and streamlined way, then of course, as you're within your strategy, you're then able to say, how am I delivering this value to my customer? Brian will then jump in. I don't know if you have anything you want to add yet, Joel, but Brian, we're going to go into the next slide to talk through some of these benefits.
Well, in terms of adding, nothing for me just yet, but in terms of our attendees, no, not many of you can see the screen. I see a Q&A button, and at any stage, if you have any questions, just click that button, fill your questions, and periodically I'll be asking the panelists, you know, just I don't want to interrupt them, but yeah, they've come to give you guys the information. So yeah, at any stage that I see that there are questions in that Q&A box, I'll ask them to the panelists so that you can have your burning questions answered. So yeah, back to you now, Brian.
No, please interrupt us. We thrive on questions. So as Brandon mentioned there, and it's a super important point, you know, creating value, you know, bringing optimizations into your business, creating value for your customers and for your citizens. And that's what everybody looks at when they think about digital transformation. And that's what digital transformation is supposed to deliver to us and to your customers and to your citizens. And all those increased efficiencies, for example, as Brandon mentioned, getting those tasks completed faster, improving that customer service, which is something that we all really hate doing, isn't it? Calling customer service, getting a bad, you know, response or getting a bad experience when it comes to that. And I think over the last few years, we've all been seriously burned by, you know, these bots that answer a lot of our questions, right? So we're all naturally, you know, careful about AI assistance because we're thinking it's going to be the same thing. We'll talk a little bit about that later as well. You know, being able to get your product to your market faster. I'll give you an example later of an SME company that was able to do this really, really well. But that is also one of the key benefits of digital transformation. Taking yourself down this road, improving access to information gives people, the right people, the right access to the right information at the right time. So a lot of people think, well, if I've got all this information and I put it all together into a single location, you know, how do I share that information? And again, we want to make sure that organizations know how to do that and understand that there is benefits to that as well, okay? Because we all naturally protect our information. We don't want people to get access to it. And then, of course, the AI workload improvements overall. And as we all know, AI is coming down the road. It is coming very, very fast. And honestly, any organization that is not thinking about AI today, your products will be dead in a year and a half to 2 years if you do not take some action right now to manage that. Okay. And it is very easy to get AI into your organization. It is not as hard as you think it is. So we'll help with a little bit of that too. I'm just trying to switch slides here. So a lot of the challenges that we've mentioned and Joel mentioned, you know, you have all these long queues in places, people waiting to do things that can be done under a normal circumstance. You know, going to get your license or going to get your passport renewed, a birth certificate, or whatever it is. Traditionally, we have to go to places, queue up, we have to fill in all these forms, you wait for a while, and it takes up your whole day to do these things. A lot of governments right now are looking at ways of doing this much more efficiently. Overly complicated processes. The reason a lot of these long queues exist is because we have overly complicated processes. And the reality is, you need people, humans in those processes, to be able to fulfill a lot of the demand that is out there for all of these different documents that we're trying to get. Even if it is purchasing a product from your organization as an enterprise business or as an SME business, someone has to go to get that from you, or there's a manual process to get a payment to you. Again, digital transformation simplifies all of this. It takes it all down a level and makes things easier. And then, of course, the bad customer service is something that we mentioned earlier, which is an absolute pet peeve of mine, as you can tell by my mentioning it multiple times. Sorry, I went backwards there. And you can see what the data is telling us. And I know most of you have probably read the report already, or at least glanced through it. I would suggest a deeper read of it. And there is more data that we did collect during this report that we didn't publish yet, right? And we'll make that information available over time. But there's very good information in here about what the challenges are, right? What the data is telling us. 60% of organizations are currently delayed in their transformations. So what went wrong there? Why are we delayed? What's happening on the ground level that's causing these delays? 43% of SMEs have implemented less than one-third of their strategy. Now, we know that SMEs have challenges, right? Limited resources, limited skill sets. It's hard to get people when you're trying to run your business yourself. It's hard to get people and control those people to do the right things at the right time to make things move forward. That is a difficulty that a lot of SMEs face. 30,
Brown?
Go ahead,
I want
Brandon.
to add to that 43% too about the delay in having the strategy implemented, is especially when you are, that size company, having to manage both operations and innovation at the same time requires a lot more effort than people actually believe before they start the journey. So
Correct.
you're on this journey and you're willing to, or you're ready to go through your digital transformation program, and you look down the road and realize that the level of effort or work that is now required to do this is greater than I'm actually able to give because the operations of my company still need to go on. I still need to make money today.
Exactly. And you know very well, Brandon, like when we were going through the data on this, we saw the top three challenges that people are facing, and it is still people. The biggest challenge is still people. You're trying to trying to manage a lot of operational issues and at the same time innovate, and it's just such a conflictory role because you don't have the resources to push into there. So it's a great point, and it's something that we're constantly sort of preaching about when it comes to doing big projects like this. And it don't necessarily have to be a big project. You can think big and start very small and still achieve good results. And I think too, the other one was the 38%, which I think is an excellent statistic. It's something that is very telling when it comes to organizations, right? So 38% believe that their organization has the right resources. Then why so many delays? So you have data now conflicting, you see? And what we've realized is that a lot of it comes down to culture, right? Which we'll talk about in a moment. A lot of people forgot to include the rest of their organization in their digital transformation. And it is so important to do it. A lot of organizations throw digital transformation at the IT team or at the technical team and say, here you go, transform the organization. But what they're really doing is transforming the systems and not the rest of the organization, not the processes. So by the time they've gotten to stage five of their transformation, they look back and everybody's still at the beginning. And no one knows why we're doing it. No one knows why we're there. And then, of course, 37% have the confidence in and the reaction and the readiness to capitalize on digital opportunities. So there's a bit of confidence there. It's not as high as we would like, but there's a bit of confidence there. So again, the question becomes, how do we get that confidence up? And I think all of these things are interconnected. I think all of these dots need to be measured at the same time. So the question then becomes, is it something we're missing at the very beginning of our digital transformation? Or is there something happening there or not happening there that we're kind of missing? Okay. So when doing digital transformation, and I'm not going to read all of these, right? This is data. I'm pretty sure we're going to share this with everybody afterwards. It's important to bring it back down to the three key features, and that is people, process, and technology, right? Your governance is an overlay. It's something that you'll put over the entire thing to make sure that everything gets done correctly. But those people, process, and technology, you cannot forget, right? These are three key parts of any project at all, even if it's not digital transformation. Technology alone cannot solve your problem.
True.
Even companies like Digicel coming along and selling you technology, it's just not going to work if it doesn't match your people and your process. It has to match your organization. And I think that's super, super true as well, Brandon, when it comes to processes. A lot of organizations, for example, they bring in technology, they realize it doesn't match their processes. They have to change their processes, which upsets their people. And then they're back into this circle of failure again because these things happen, you see? So think very carefully. Who are my people? Who do I have? What skill sets do I have? What's my current process in doing something? And Digicel ourselves, we've experienced this. We've brought in challenging processes and forgotten certain areas, and we have to go back and do it again to get it done right. I heard a great expression, a great phrase recently. I was asking somebody, do you think we should do this? It was a different type of project, and he said to me, I think we should do it. He said to me, but do we have the time to do it twice? And I said, no, we don't. He said, well, then let's do it right the first time. In other
Fully
words,
agree.
take your time, evaluate properly, look at your people, process, and technology, and then begin in that manner. Okay.
Brian, I would also want to add to the process and technology component. So two things. Some years ago, I had the opportunity to meet someone who is a Lean Six Sigma Grandmaster, if anybody's familiar with those titles. But he goes around the world re-engineering business processes and creating new value for customers. Mm-hmm. And I sat with him one day just to have lunch, because he was kind of walking me through how to get this done before I got my Lean Six Sigma certification. And he said to me, one of the things he loved doing is going into businesses and just sitting and talking to the employees.
Yeah.
And he said 95% of the time, the solution already exists with the employees. So they're having these challenges, and maybe it's a tech challenge, but they haven't asked the people who are using the systems every day, what do you think we could do to improve this or to change this or to fix this?
Yep.
Instead, because it's a tech challenge, you run to your tech team, as you rightly said, and you give them this flood of money and say, go and implement or deploy this new system, this new solution, go and visit this vendor and see how it works. And you carry this thing down from, you know, some far country into our already not working process to deploy it into. And we know that if you automate or put any kind of technology that is automated onto a broken process, all it does is inflate the broken process. Especially if you decide to put a report overlay on top of that process, all of the things that you thought never existed suddenly exist today.
Exactly.
And then you actually, at that point, it becomes even more scary, because you never realize how broken your systems were. And you have no choice but to report these things to the board. So whilst before you were, you know, floating by being quote unquote broken enough to be able to get by, you have no choice now but to fix it. So yeah. If you had spent the time before to assess, what does my current state process look like? How are we actually trying to do the work? And understanding that not just from quote unquote process flow, I describe process flows as boxes and lines. Mm-hmm. It's boxes and lines with text in them. It's not that difficult to think about. But when you think about your process flows and then you overlay that with your technology, you overlay that with your data, and you start to see how things are flowing through the organization, you get a better picture of what it is we're actually trying to do. And then simple elimination of activities, the things that we no longer need to do, the things that we have system to be able to get done. And instead of what a lot of people tend to try to do, what a lot of businesses look at is, we now have this piece of technology that can get this done, let's get rid of these set of employees. But then you forget that these employees also have these 10 other things that they're working on to make your business function that you haven't considered in the entire transformation journey. So tomorrow you now need to get something else to get these things done, because you didn't actually examine the full process. All you did was look at the technology component. So in these four spaces that we're in, it's very important, and they're on screen for a reason, that we actually look at all aspects individually and collectively. Yeah.
Yeah, so true. So true. I heard one business consultant, he said the worst thing you can hear when you walk into a company is, oh, we've always done it that way.
Yeah.
He said it is the worst thing you can hear when you walk in the door, because that means that the organization has tried to do things without bringing the people with them. And that's why we want to talk a little bit about culture, okay? And taking your people with you, right? It's extremely important to make sure that you bring those people.
And before we go any further, well, let's finish
our point. Go ahead, Joe.
Because I see a couple questions coming in based on what we were talking about just now. So I guess want to have them addressed before you guys move a little further. Because I'm actually happy that you mentioned that question in terms of how do you get that confidence. Because based on what Brandon was saying, I wrote it down. Anything the customer is willing to pay for, if what you define as valuable. So then my question became, you know, but what if they didn't understand the value of it? Did that make it less valuable in terms of, I'm not willing to pay for it, so it means it's not valuable, but in fact, it could be valuable. And hence, I was happy that Brian mentioned, you know, how do you get that confidence up? Because I think when you went through the processes, it began to answer the question in terms of how do you help people to see the value in what they were originally not willing to pay for? But it takes me now into the first question that I see here, which is one, how do you start the transformation process? And I think you guys kind of began to address that slightly. So that's the first question. I'm going to tie it into another question here, which is, hi, as a newly appointed digital transformation officer, what key strategies and initial steps would you recommend I take to effectively drive digital change within my organization, considering factors like cultural alignment, technology adoption, and stakeholder engagement? So you guys want to repeat that, or are you happy there?
Can you go back
Super.
to the value part first?
So that was mine. That was me. So I was just saying that it was a case of you had mentioned that you're going to define it as anything the customer is willing to pay for. And in my head, I was saying that, but maybe what if somebody's not willing to pay for it, but it actually has value? And it's a case of you need to have them understand the value. And then so I was happy that Brian all answered, or rather, that question of how do you get that confidence up? Because I think that was tying into how do you help them see the value?
Great
Yeah, but
question. Let me add to that too. So
uh-huh
in the space of value, and this is based on the lean methodology, which we use a lot when we're doing process reengineering. Based on
mm-hmm.
how value is defined, you have what you call value-adding activities. Again, these are activities that the customers are willing to pay for. Then you have non-value-adding activities. In the non-value-adding activities space, that is further broken down into two categories. You have what are called essential non-value-adding activities. And these are the things that they're not necessarily willing to pay for, but they are required for the business to move forward. Those are essential. There's nothing you can do about it. It could be regulatory reporting, it could be something that's policy related coming from the board, it could be something that a system needs to get the process going. Whatever that is, it is required to get the system, the process going and the value delivered to the customer. But as far as they are concerned, I'm not willing to pay for this. I really don't care. Then you have the things in the same non-value adding bucket that they consider as process wastes. And these are things that just create frustration for customers. So you can talk about, you hear Bran have been speaking so far about just having bad customer service. And that bad customer service could be small things. It could be things like producing a lot of scrap in your process. It could be producing more than what the customer wants. It could be waiting in a line for half a day to get things done. The lean methodology defines these things into eight different groups, which I won't get into for this presentation. And those are just three that I defined a while ago. But if you have classified your value into those three buckets, then you're able to see for the things that we call essential non-value adding, that is actually where you decide to put your technology first. Because you want to put your least amount of valuable resource, which in this case is your employees, to the thing that the customer is willing to pay for. So if the customer is willing to pay for it, then that's where I want to put my employees. If the customer is not willing to pay for it, I need to automate that. I need that to be something I don't need to think about. I just want to see reports that that is working. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for sure.
Perfect.
The only thing I would add to that as well is value comes in many different formats, as we've mentioned multiple times, right? And there are things that are valuable to your organization, right? Some of which you can then pass on to your customers as additional value in your products and your services that you provide to them. But let's say one of the values of doing digital transformation becomes, oh, we save so much time doing this. We actually are now able to take four people and move them into this department to actually innovate more things. And we'll get into that a little bit more near the end of this. But value comes in many different formats. The second thing I would say is you mentioned the confidence comment, Joel, right? And it's how do we get that confidence? I don't know. I'm pretty sure everybody on the call has experienced this, right? When you step into a room with a senior manager, or you're the senior manager, and I'm specifically thinking about, this newly appointed digital transformation, manager, and you talk to a bunch of people and you say, we're going to do digital transformation, and you get this look, right? And as soon as you get that, something's wrong. Their confidence level in us doing this is not right. Now, that could be many different things, and that's why we're talking about all of these topics, because we want to make sure, is it that they don't believe we can do it? Do we not have the tech to do it? Do we have the know-how to even begin this process? And so I would say to him, whoever asked that question is, make sure when you begin with a confidence level so high that you know exactly who's supporting you from a senior level. Make sure we do or do not have the resources to do this. Do not use operational resources. They will get sick of your project and they will get sucked into, they'll create more work to stay away from you. Okay? You've got to have a separation of time. And don't do this thing. I've seen so many companies do this now where they say, oh, these people will dedicate 40% of their time to your project. No, they won't. That won't happen, right? They will. That will not happen. They will dedicate 10% of their time to your project. So,
if
so
that much,
if even that much, right? And again, bringing your people with you is so important. So, if you as a newly appointed digital transformation officer sit down with the entire organization, get that top level buy-in support, have a conversation with all your people, like promote some of your people to supporters, you know, from all different levels and say, look, you're all part of this. You're all informers, you're all consultants, you're all, you know, influencers when it comes to this stuff. And I want you to be part of it and understand it. Don't forget, bring in new talent as well. Don't just pick people that have been there for years. They don't know what they're doing. Okay, you need to bring new people who have experienced new things, new talent, because they've seen it already happening in other places.
As a matter of fact, Brian, for the especially on the talent component,
yeah.
If you've been there, if you've been in the organization for a long time, in the, I learned this many years ago in the consulting space, that you suffer from what is called the cataract effect, which is I'm blinded by the fact that I've been doing this for so long. So even though I have not been efficient, even though I am producing a lot of scrap or waste in my process, as far as I'm concerned, this is the best way to do it because I've been doing it for the last 25 years.
Oh, you're still doing your job.
I'm still doing my job. So it's not that, and it's not a fault on the person or that's doing the job. It's nature. It's how you've been built, right? You build norms in how you get things done. And those norms may not necessarily be the best for the business, but it's the norm that has gotten you to this place today while the world is still advancing.
Well, what did we say earlier? It's always been done this way.
It's always been done this way.
Right.
Yeah.
It's the worst thing you can do. And don't forget to as well to, you know, energize your team, right? Nobody's excited about taking on more work, right? Why would they be excited about helping you with a new project that they just don't believe in? So make them believe in it, energize them, and teach people what the outcomes will be for their work, how it's going to impact them. Today, you're doing all of this work manually. I want to make sure we can do this automatically for you so you can go retrain and do more things. Maybe,
correct.
You know, you prefer to do marketing, don't you? Well, why can't we retrain you and help you get there? You know, energize them and make sure that we do it truthfully, of course, you know?
I realize that you're going into our culture piece very, very nicely. But so some of the things that you mentioned actually aligns very well with the change management methodologies that we, all of them, it doesn't matter which one you choose.
Yeah.
But if you use one of the more recent ones, the ProSci ADKAR model, the first two things refer to awareness and desire. So if you think about trying to get your company, your people, up to where you are, one, they're not aware that you're trying to get this thing done. And two, they don't care that you're trying to get this thing done. At the end of the day, they get a paycheck for doing their operational duties.
Yep.
Now, why should I go about trying to be innovative when we've tried to be innovative 5 times in the past and it hasn't worked?
Correct.
You've developed this almost culture of failure, and nobody wants to fail all the time. Exactly. You have to find a way to reignite hope as a part of this change journey in building that culture, to be able to get through your transformation door. And until you're actually able to achieve that, which is, and I'm jumping a bit, it's one of the reasons why when you're doing any kind of deployment project, you want to have quick wins. It's not because you just want to do something and do something for doing it's sake. It is because you have to find a way to demonstrate success, to build the kind of trust that you have with your team. It is not just to get money faster. It's not, those things are added benefits. But when you want to get your team there, especially if you've failed several times before, you have to show success quickly so that people can say, oh, maybe there is an opportunity for this to work.
Yeah. And remember our people process technology. The people part, they are humans. Don't forget that, right? So how do you incentivize humans to do it? You give them something to look forward to. I saw one company did it, and they did a great job of this, actually. They gamified it. Okay, they turned it into a game where different teams could earn points for progress, and they were rewarded handsomely for, you know, big jumps in the digital transformation. They also were informed of the impact on their part themselves. But I thought it was a great idea to do it. That doesn't work in every organization, of course. You've got to look at your organization and figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
But when it comes to the, you know, all of those things that we do, the right tools, the right people, the right processes, all of it comes down to the transformation goals, right? And those transformation goals, you need to clearly define the outcome I want at the end of this is to improve my customer service engagement with my customers. I want my customers to be happy to call me. There was a company a few years ago, I can't quite remember the name of them. I will in a moment, but what they did was every pair of shoes they gave two pairs, right? First of all, so when you bought a pair of shoes online from them, they sent you two pairs. If anything happened to one of those pairs of shoes, there was no debates, no arguments. They had built it into their process. You got an automatic pair of shoes, right? So the customers were never unhappy to call customer service. They were always delighted to do it. Of course, they got some free shoes, right? But it was so effective that they sold so many shoes, they had to open up multiple more manufacturing plants. And that's a great problem to have. Just because they defined that dealing with our customers in a better manner is better for us as an organization. So it's very important. Yeah. I mean, you look through the list here, you know, organizations want to fundamentally transform their business processes or models. Who doesn't? This is so important to everybody. We want to make sure things run smoothly. Improve customer experience and engagement, of course. Improve innovation. And this is the part of the challenge that, Brendan, you were mentioning earlier, was that a lot of organizations can't innovate today because they're so caught up with so many operational issues that they don't get time to do it. It's very hard to innovate when you're tied doing operational things. So those operational things need to become a thing of the past for your organization. That frees up people, that frees up processes, that frees up technology for new things. Very, very important. And that's one of the areas, which we'll get to in a moment, where AI can help.
Sure.
A lot of organizations want to improve business decision-making processes. I can't tell you how many CEOs that I've worked for who are sick signing off on purchase orders that they don't understand. You know, how many CEOs I've walked into and you know, shown them two different quotes from two different vendors, and they have no clue what the two different, what's the difference between the two vendors. So what do? They pick the cheapest one because that's all they know. It's cheaper. So getting the right information to the right people in the organization so they can make those better decisions. And then, of course, improving cost efficiencies. And if you look at the difference between 2024 and 2022, in the response rates here, like 55% of people want to improve that customer service. Why? Because they know customers don't come back if they have a bad experience. 53% want to improve cost efficiencies versus 42% in 2022. That is only going to grow over the next couple of years. One of the biggest areas that we discovered, and this wasn't really a surprise, but it was an area that we kind of knew was growing, but it grew a lot more than we did expect, was the mobile technologies, right? Every business, no matter if you're a government or an enterprise or an SME, you want your customers and your products to be interactable, if that's a word, on a mobile app with somebody, okay? Because everybody's carrying around a mobile app with them, right? My current bank has no physical locations, zero. I cannot go somewhere to talk to somebody, but their customer service on the mobile app is second to none. So I'm happy to interact with them on that mobile app. I do everything on that mobile app because they've developed it so well, they've done it so carefully, they've thought about everything. So mobile technology is still king when it comes to organizations wanting to digitally transform. It is the number one technology that you need to think about if you're doing a digital transformation. It is so important as part of the process. And of course, you need to make sure that whatever you're developing, you've got to be very careful to make sure that the data is well protected, but also shareable.
One of the things about this data space, right? So when I started consulting some time ago, I was not a fan of governance because I felt like governance was trying to stifle my innovation. And then a few years ago, my boss at the time challenged me to look into how can we utilize governance, laws, legislation to improve or Yeah, let's use the word improve, how it is that we actually transform companies. And when I started going down that rabbit hole, I then realized that governance is actually great. Laws are not as bad as we make them out to be, especially if they're designed for the customers. So when you think about, or in some instances, the citizens. So when you think about the state of data protection in the Caribbean specifically, you would realize that there are a lot of things that are happening to us very rapidly in the Caribbean that we have to become comfortable with very quickly. One of those things being AI, one of those things being open data, those things being an open data exchange platform. So all of these cloud computing, all of these things are creating room or need for us to find ways to make sure that the data that we're using is properly secured. And whenever we think about digital transformation, in most instances, it actually refers to the sharing of personal data. Not in all instances, but in most instances, it refers to the sharing of personal data. Now, if we're sharing personal data without any kind of trust in that sharing space, then the people who should be participating in your digital transformation exercise, for them to get the value, will not want to. They're going to say, no. I'm going to find somebody who's using brick and mortar. I'm going to find the man who probably wants to use cash, because clearly your online payment platform is going to expose my credit card. I don't want to use it. We're going to find ways to not change. And the truth is, and I learned this from my boss some years ago, that whenever you decide to push against someone's belief system, and that belief system doesn't have to be a religious system, it could be the thing that I believe today to be true. So if I believe that cash is true today, and I'm pushing against that cash system to say, let's go digital, but I have not found a way to show you that this actually makes sense, or that it is trustworthy, or that we're able to get it done in a manner that protects you, then I'm going to stick to what I know. I'm going to push back hard at the thing that you're trying to get done. And I'm going to make up reasons specifically to make sure that this doesn't get done.
That doesn't. And again, it goes back to what we said earlier. If you're not bringing the people with you, whether they're inside or outside your organization, they're just not going to believe it. How many organizations, Brandon, across the region have developed cashless solutions that just didn't work?
Correct. They've developed national ID systems that just didn't work.
Yeah.
They've developed so many systems, B2B systems to allow you to be able to share data between businesses for ease of transactions for the customer. But the customer doesn't want to participate in it because they don't trust the system that is working today.
Yeah.
So you have to spend it, which is one of the reasons why these laws now become even more important, and not just the presence of the laws, but the enforcement of the laws. So this is both for the business and the government, as well as those people who are holding those businesses accountable and the government accountable to these laws. So you have to start by building trust for the customer and the citizen. And the thing about data protection too is that it helps with facilitating regional and global competitiveness as well as collaboration. So I want to backtrack a little bit on one of the things that we're talking about as it relates to digital transformation and our ability to do business. So if we don't transform, one of the reasons why it then becomes even harder for us is the world is already open to global competition because of the internet. And these companies that have probably a lot more money than we think they do, they're going to find a way to penetrate our market in ways that we probably can't because we didn't spend the time to transform. But if we spend the time today to actually transform, then even though we are small or we think we're small, we actually become more competitive than we are just because we spent the time to strategize and go down the road of transforming. So there's actually no, we can't wait too long to get these things done because we're going to shoot ourselves in the foot.
Yeah.
Right. So and because of how data protection works right now, it is opening up the space for global companies and regional companies to compete with each other, because they're creating ways for example, and I won't state the country, but there are a few countries actually in the Caribbean that are now allowing you to take your bank account and just move it to another bank without having to open a new bank account. So you lift your data from where it is in one bank and carry it over to another bank.
Really good.
Yeah, so those things are becoming more and more prevalent, not just in the banking arena, but in as many sectors and industries that you think because of these laws that are existing today. So competition is actually becoming easier. And if we decide to not participate, then
Yeah,
we're going to
we're
be
in
a
trouble.
dying company very soon.
Agreed.
Then, of course, this data protection allows us to do a lot more safeguarding against cyber threats. So a lot of data privacy and data protection laws speak to things like data minimization, where you're only collecting the thing that you need. And if you're only collecting the thing that you need, then you're also doing what you need to do to protect the thing that you need. And one of the reasons why I like good cloud solutions, I'm putting the word good in there specifically, but one of the reasons why I like good cloud solutions is that a lot of these companies who've spent the time to invest in cloud have also spent the time to secure their cloud. So if you actually think that your on-prem environment is more secure than a cloud environment, you probably need to reevaluate your security. A lot of these companies have spent good money, big money, to make sure that this environment is one of the safest things that you could ever want to invest with, because this is what you're selling. So you're not trying to sell a million things. You're selling cloud storage. So if they're only selling cloud storage, every dollar that they make is going back into making sure that your cloud storage environment is trustworthy.
Correct. And
So yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to say, it's super interesting because it really does come back to the systems again, right? So you brought it back around to, what are the key technologies that are very important for people to bring in. So we've talked a lot about the sort of people, we've talked a lot about the process, but bringing it back to those key technologies for a second, right? And when we look at the data that people have responded with, about the future of digital transformation, which emerging tech do you foresee as fundamental? And at first, I was a little surprised by these numbers, but then I realized there was reasons behind these things. So if you think only 15 respondents said that cybersecurity was fundamental, but that's not the real statistic, is it? Because everybody believes cybersecurity is fundamental. But when it comes to digital transformation, it's how do I do cybersecurity at the same time as I'm doing, digital transformation? How do I do AI and implement AI, digital payments and cloud computing? Everybody knows you have to have that cloud computing element in order to be able to complete your digital transformation project. You've got to have it, you see, or you've got to have some form of cloud application that you can do. If you're an SME, for example, you don't need to build a huge infrastructure, but you need to understand what your partner can do for you, and you need to understand how they do that, right? And just to quickly flick through the next two or three slides so we don't go too much out of time here, a couple of those things are cybersecurity. Make sure you have a proper framework in place for this, make sure your people are trained. If you just train your people alone, you're already eliminating up to 70% of all attacks from your organization. Now, those attacks are a little bit higher during digital transformation because you're moving so many different things around. Make sure you train your people how to be savvy when it comes to these things. DevSecOps. Not everybody can afford DevSecOps, but what I advise you to do is, sorry, I didn't switch slides there. What I advise you to do is to make sure that you bring cybersecurity with you. So everything you do, ask the cybersecurity questions. And it doesn't have to be a big one. I've seen companies develop frameworks on one-page documents in their organizations, SME organizations, one-page documents. And all it was a list of rules. You must change your password. You must update your software once per month. You must do this, you must do that. And it kept everybody on a reasonable level of cybersecurity. If you think of things like, for example, endpoint protection, you're talking $4, $5 per month to protect an endpoint. It's not that expensive. So even if we do the minimum, it has a great impact on this. Make sure whatever you're doing is real time. Okay. No point finding out 2 hours later that somebody's in your system. And make sure internally you develop a zero trust, no tolerance to anybody walking in. I mentioned it earlier, even if your CEO walks in and says, I need access to this here, your answer is no. I'm sorry, I know you're the CEO. Unless you sign this document to say you are responsible if something happens, until then, I'm responsible for something happens and you will fire me if I don't do it. So be strict with people in your organization. We mentioned the advanced cloud computing. 47% of respondents said that this was very important as part of their business overall. Okay. And again, that is secure servers, it's applications, it's a data center, it's hybrid platforms, and of course, business disaster recovery, which is now, as we all know, part of cybersecurity. So organizations now are saying, well, I need a defense tactic, but I also need a recovery tactic if the worst case scenario happens. Because you can't just sit there and say, oh, well, we got breached, it happened. You've got to find a way to get back on track within 2 to 4 hours and get your business running again. And then, of course, the AI piece, which I'm going to spend just a minute or so on, right? AI is becoming so important. And we're not talking about Gen AI here, okay? We're not talking about ChatGPT or Copilot or any of those things, although those applications are being developed to do a lot more than just generative tasks. And like right now, Digicel's using AI in 3 or 4 of our products because it's helping people to do things right. To give you an example, one of the firewall solutions that we manage for customers, the AI is embedded in there. The customer's engineers or Digicel's engineers will be changing something on that firewall as per their customer's request. And the AI will intervene and go, I notice you're changing this policy. Would you like me to take a look at it for you? Or would you like me to do it for you? You see, so it's there as that secondary backup. It's not costing you anything extra, but it's there to help you do these things. So AI is going to become so important to improve sales and accuracy. I saw a fantastic solution when I was in Las Vegas a couple of months ago. And it was basically, if you have a sales team or anybody out there selling, the AI will connect to all of your different sales sources. It will speak to your customers on your behalf in real language. You know, we can even make it sound Jamaican or Trinidadian or whatever country you're from at this stage. And it
don't
will
like
talk.
Joel.
Yeah, well, we could actually mimic Joel's voice and get the AI to respond in Joel's voice.
But I'm right here. I can give you my voice.
We'll send all the calls to you, Joel. But that's the beauty of it. And again, don't be afraid of the past. Okay, I know we've all been burnt by bots. Okay, everybody hates talking to a bot. This is different, and I strongly suggest you take a look at it. Okay.
Before you move on,
sure.
Yeah, go ahead, Joel.
No, because I know AI is a very, very big topic, and I believe actually just yesterday we were having a little pre-discussion in terms of the fear of AI. But I just want to ask, how can persons educate themselves on AI as it relates to their business? Given, I guess that when we hear AI, as you said, a lot of people just think ChatGPT, all different things. So, like, as it pertains to the businesses, those who are locked on, how can they educate themselves on AI?
So, I guess the easy answer is I want to say to Google, but that sounds too easy, right? But when you think about AI, actually, when you think about education, there's good education and bad education. I would first say to one, look up a reputable educating environment. So if you want to get like real education, you could go LinkedIn Learning or, you know, Coursera or edX or something of that nature. You could do those things. Or you could do Google searches. You could also, if you want to be a little more creative, since we're talking about AI, you could go to an AI, whether it be Gemini or ChatGPT or Claude or Copilot or whatever you want to use, could go to an AI and say, my business is in investment management, and I want to know, how can I implement AI in my business to improve productivity and operations? Mm-hmm. And it will give you a list of things that you could do within your business that could help to improve your business. Now, how great this can get, and this is keeping it very simple, is imagine, let's say that you have, let's say that you have an AML environment. An AML is anti-money laundering. Let's say you have an AML, you need to do reporting, you need to talk about your KYC, you need to, or you know, your customer data and all of those things. And you're in the compliance unit and you need to be doing monthly reporting on how you're looking. And you get a report that, of course, has a lot of data in it, but you need to spend the time to churn that data to figure out what the data is saying. You can actually implement AI on top of that data, just that data set, not the entire internet, that data set, and say, tell me what you see from this data. And it can then start doing all of your correlations, all of your statistics, all of your flags, everything that you can think about that could be descriptive of that data, and give you a report. Mm-hmm. And your work then becomes much lighter. And again, this is not trying to create hard tasks. We're not trying to eliminate the compliance officer. We're actually trying to allow the compliance officer to do the thing that they're asked to do, which is to think.
Yeah.
We want the AI to do the more mundane, repetitive tasks. Go figure out what the data is saying.
Yeah.
After you've done that, go ahead, Brian.
No, sorry, I didn't mean to cut you there. Sorry.
No, that's fine. It's after the AI has done that component, the compliance officer then takes the report and interprets what the AI has now made a lot more easier to read. And you can then do the informed decision-making part of the work that you're actually hired to do, rather than sitting down for 2 weeks trying to figure out what this data is telling you.
And like the fear of AI, right? And don't get me wrong, it's not completely without cause.
Yeah.
Right? We've been told in the past that the internet was great, but there's a dark side to the internet, as we all know, right? We've all been told in the past that IoT and smart solutions were great, but there's a dark side to those too. So there is a dark side to everything. Stay informed. Do your Googling. Okay. There are free courses out there that can help you to understand AI on a more basic level on how it works. I think Google and Copilot and a few different organizations do these free courses, and you can just learn the basics first of all. And I can guarantee you that if we don't do something with AI, I mean, look at the number right now, 13% view it as fundamental to their industry's growth. I guarantee by the time we do this report next year or the year after, that will be in the high 80s. There's no way that number is not in the high 80s. And that's my prediction for 2026, right?
So you heard it here, folks.
We can check back and see if I'm right or wrong.
But no, you said 80%, Brian?
In the 80s, yes.
Okay.
The pace at which this is going to happen is going to be exponential, because look at the benefits. Look what the outcomes are to implementing this. And that's why the incentives are there to do it. So yes, the fear is there. AI is not going to turn Terminator. It is not going to destroy us, right? The current AIs are trained on a section of data from the internet. GPT-4, for example, is trained on a lot of data from the internet and from libraries and all these different areas. It's not at the point yet where it can really cause us any harm or damage. However, be careful what you put into it, right? Not all the data is properly protected yet. I heard, I think it might have been McKinsey said, you know, we've opened up Jurassic Park, but we haven't installed the electric fences yet, right? So not all of the protections are fully in place. Yes, yes, AI can have hallucinations. Yes, AI can be a little bit racist or sexist. So we've got to make sure that we're using a reputable AI with proper safeguards and protections. For an example of this, take a look at Google's Gemini. I'm not promoting it, but I've used it. And they have their 7 AI rules that the AI cannot cross. And they're very, very careful. I personally would much rather have a sensitive AI than one that's completely open. I don't care about sensitivity. I want it to be sensitive to everything.
And if you're actually implementing AI in your organization, you could limit the data set, not to everything on the internet. You could create small language models specific to your environment.
Correct.
So it doesn't feel as though you're being bombarded by the things that are not yours.
I was just going to say, exactly to your point, I was working with an AI a couple of weeks ago, and they said to me, give me one page about you, Brian. So I wrote a one-page document. They plugged it into the AI, and the AI wanted to talk to me for 3 hours about me. It was such a great therapy session. But the AI was able to learn so much about me just from that one piece of information. Now, can you imagine what that can do for your organization? Can you imagine what that could do for your citizens?
Yeah.
Right? Being able to help that citizen, hey, healthcare issues, or, you know, hey, by the way, your license is coming up for renewal. Would you like me to go ahead and fill in that application for you? So many great stuff can come out of this. But yes, not saying there's no bad stuff. There is a dark side to everything. Let me just move on, because I think we're running low on time here.
Yeah.
And there's great examples out there of organizations who have done it. I'm going to skip over Malioana, Brandon, for now, right? Just to save a bit of time here.
Yeah.
But, you know, we've seen organizations like Malioana, like JPS, and like, you know, some SME companies implement some very, very basic things. Like you look at JPS, for example, in Jamaica, they implemented a mobile app that now tells you your bill, lets you pay for your bill, and it shows you your usage in pretty much near real time. The amount of calls that has saved JPS, the amount of benefits that JPS are now experiencing. Why? Because less of their people are taking less calls about less problems, and they've moved those people into areas where they can now innovate new things, all because of something they developed on mobile to help deal with some of those issues. So don't be afraid to do these things. This little SME company in Trinidad, they contacted me. They basically said, look, we have no way to digitally really talk to our customers. We call them or we send them emails, but it wasn't very efficient. We got them an omni-channel platform. It connected to all of their different sources, WhatsApp, Telegram, Facebook, Instagram, email, all of these different areas. They were able to speak to all of their customers at the same time. And not only that, but the customers could respond. Initially, the customers would speak to the AI, and then the AI would pass it on to a real human once the customer is ready to purchase or once the customer is ready to deal with something, for example, a payment or whatever it was, you see? So massive efficiencies in even small organizations. So preparing for your journey, let's go back to what we mentioned earlier, is very, very important, right? You have to think carefully. And again, I go back to the question earlier, you know, as a newly appointed, you know, digital transformation officer, right? Do prepare your journey properly. It will make all the difference. And don't be afraid. For example, let's say you get through that journey. Okay. Let's say you get to stage 5 here in your implementation and you're monitoring something to see if it works and it doesn't work, go back and fix it. Because if you finish, it's only going to add additional problems to your organization. It's going to add additional mundane processes, and your team are going to be swamped with more operational issues that you now have to deal with because of your digital transformation. Go back and fix the problem and then finish your journey.
Yeah, digital transformation is not linear. It's not a straight road that you drive down from point A to point B to point C and then we're done. A lot of it is going forward and realizing, as Brian says, there are things that I need to address before I finish this. Yes, I may deploy this small component now, and because this component works and it's workable and we can deploy it. But there are things that I then need to address. And I need to go back and address those things quickly. Yep. And that also means I must be implementing, as a part of the transformation journey, excellent communication. Excellent communication. I need to make sure that if I'm going to deploy something that's half ready, everyone using it must know it is half ready. Because if I deploy it and create a fanfare around something that is half ready, and they don't know it is half ready, they're going to not trust this half ready thing, even though we all know it wasn't supposed to be fully ready.
False expectations. Yeah.
False expectations.
Yeah, fully agree. It's really important, guys, to take everybody with you on your journey, okay? And again, just as a reminder, you know, these simple steps, you know, evaluate your business's readiness. And if it's not ready, don't do it, right? I strongly advise organizations to do it because the long-term benefits are incredible when you do. But if it's not ready to go, don't do it. Number 2, expert guidance and consultancy frameworks. Don't be afraid to talk to organizations. There are organizations out there that will give you 20 hours of an expert, and he will come in, he'll talk to your organization, he'll take a look at your people, he will take a look at your processes, what technology you're currently using, and he will advise you on, say, look, I don't think you're ready, or you need to develop these things in order to be able to get your people ready, or you need to understand that these processes are going to be affected while you're doing these things. And then, of course, step 3 is, you know, delivering the ideal technology on the correct resources with the correct type of implementation, which is extremely important as well. Okay, so again, I'm sorry for jumping through those last couple of slides really quickly. Again, we will make this available to everybody, but I wanted to, Joel's pinging me here, let me know there's a couple of questions that he's getting and he wants to try and get those questions in as well.
Well, actually, I think based on everything you guys went through, that you actually have addressed the questions that I see here, because the only other one would have been, what should be top priorities for a digital transformation officer in the first 3 months? But I believe that the last 2 slides you guys explained would have spoken specifically to what to do. I don't know if you want to add quickly to that or not, but that's the only question in technicality that is outstanding at the moment based on what I see here.
The question is, what should they focus on?
Yeah, what should you focus on within the first 3 months?
Oh, knowing your strategy. People think, cannot say that. A lot of times we underestimate the value of a good strategy. We spend the time, if you think about, let's call it the building blocks of digital transformation. You have your governance layer, you have your strategic layer, you have your implementation layer. And in that space specifically, a lot of people tend to spend the time, let's use this slide. A lot of people tend to spend the time in the implementation layer because that's where things get fun and interesting. That's where we get to use all of the nice tools, and that's where we can click things, and that's where we see the shiny buttons. But we haven't spent the time to understand what are we trying to achieve. If nothing is true, then all things are true. If we haven't spent the time to define what we're trying to do, then everything that we're trying to do is true. And so we're all going down different paths, trying to get to different outcomes.
Yeah.
You have
clear
to
vision.
You have to have a vision.
You have to have a clear vision.
You need to know where you're going. Go ahead,
and Brad. You have to know that your organization can actually implement that vision. I don't know if anybody remembers this. A couple of years ago, it was one of the transport companies. I can't remember if it was UPS or DHL, but they got this new CFO into the organization, right? And this guy came with a, you know, fresh talent. He came with some crazy ideas. And he said to them, I think we should make all of our UPS, our delivery vans, only turn
UPS.
Right. UPS, right? We should make all of our vans only turn right. And everybody thought he was crazy. Naturally, right? Because it comes out of the blue. Why would we do that? If a place is over there on the left, why would you make him go right to get there, right? So he convinced them to test the theory. Okay, because he saw the vision. He knew, he mapped it out and knew what was going to happen in this case. They saved massive amounts of fuel by just going right. They saved massive amounts of accidents because all nearly 60, 70% of accidents in the US happen on cross sections when you're turning left, right? Customers were happier because they were getting their parcels delivered much, much quicker. So he was able to transform that organization with very simple things just by having a proper vision and by making sure that the top level supported him. So in your first 3 months, make sure you get that top level buy-in. Make sure you have a proper plan, you know, and take a look at your people, process, and technology. Do we actually have what it takes to do this? Or am I sucking resources from operational things to try to do this, which, as we know, never works?
All right, well, final question I believe we have here. I don't know if we have the answers for this one, but will participants have access to the course? So I know for sure that we had questions on the slides, and yes, the slides will be available, but the question is, will they have access to the recording as well?
I'm not sure. I don't see why not. I mean, this is anybody can sign up, and I guess anybody can see it, but yeah. We'll check with the marketing team. I'm pretty sure the answer is yes, but let us check it. And if it is, we'll make sure and publish it, and anybody can rewatch and take a look at it again. And of course, don't be afraid to reach out to Brandon. I'm specifically putting Brandon in that point position there. anybody who knows me knows I need an AI assistant to answer my emails. So well, Brandon's a super smart guy, and honestly, he, you know, I know his camera's a little out of focus there, but he's extremely handsome and he knows exactly what he's doing. Digital transformation. Okay. So do please reach out to one of the team. Any of the team will help you or point you in the right direction. We have masses of information about this. Mm-hmm. I'm not trying to sell Digicel or Simtai here. And I really want to be able to provide, you know, just some guidance for organizations. Everybody in the region benefits, including me. And, you know, I've been living here for the last 15 years now, and I absolutely love the Caribbean. So I don't feel like going anywhere just yet. So I really want to see organizations digitally transform. And of course, we'll be here to help, you know, or assist in any way.
All right. Well, I thought we had that with the final one, but very quickly, gentlemen, I don't want to put a timer on you. So I'm going to say in 30 seconds, answer this one. Right. How do we get employees to adapt to new changes in that digital transformation?
Great question. Great question. Really good. I'll take the first crack at it in 30 minutes. Incentivize them. 30
minutes.
I would just say incentivize them. Remember they are humans. Bring them on your journey by explaining to them how it's going to impact their job positively.
I think that answers the question. I don't think there's anything else to add. So remember earlier we spoke about the first two things in the ADKAR model, awareness and desire. You have to, in bringing them on the change, you need to help them to build that desire. And that could be through some kind of incentivizing scheme. And incentivizing doesn't always mean paying them money, right? It could mean training them. It could mean helping them to get a new skill set. It could mean a lot of things, but it depends on what that resistance is in their not wanting to be a part of the change.
I love that you added that incentivization and not only money, because I think that's where people automatically go to, okay, we need to pay them more. But if you could actually add value by saying, okay, you know what? You came into my organization with these 5 skills. Let me add one more to you so you could actually see a level of growth as well for yourself.
Yeah.
For me to talk though, but that was nice. So is there anything, gentlemen, that you want to leave as your parting words, your final statements here today?
For me, it's really just about, you know, think big. But start small if you're concerned. Not every transformation needs to be huge and all-encompassing, right? Begin somewhere where you need to fix one problem and then go from there to the next problem. I'm a huge believer in breaking a big problem down into its multiple pieces. Just have your vision and have your path to know that these are all connected, but you can still solve them one at a time.
Okay. I would add that one of the things that I think is greatly not underutilized in your transformation journey for businesses and governments is experts in your space. Because information is available, a lot of us believe as though we could get this done by reading a book or by going on Google or just calling a vendor who's implemented the solution. And a lot of times, because of the nuances within your own environment, it's not as simple as it looks. And that's the purpose of the expert coming in, who understands what are some of these things that you may not necessarily see up front that we need to consider as a part of your transformation journey. One of the big things I say to anybody, friend or customer or potential customer, is get an expert. Call an expert. Even if you're not yet at the point where you want to pay them money, get some free consultation. Take up your phone and say, I'm interested in this, and have a conversation. You may never know where that ends up.
Well, gentlemen, it's been an absolute pleasure. My takeaway from today is prepare your journey. That is the biggest takeaway for me. I know that all of the attendees certainly will be taking away something as well. I want to say thank you to all of them who joined us this morning over into the afternoon to just discuss digital transformation. Brian, I want to say thank you for taking time out of your day to discuss things another year with me. And Brandon, it's been a pleasure to welcome into this little space that we have. And I certainly look forward to having more discussions with you guys on digital transformation and anything else that you all want to talk about, to be very honest. But thank you to you, gentlemen, and thank you to all of our participants. And yes, everything we made available to you, as our lovely gentleman said. So until next time, this is goodbye, and have a wonderful time, and maybe have a wonderful lunch. I don't know.
Thank you all.
Thank you all. Thank you very much.